We don't have to go into all of the details in this table, but what I've done here is I took their outputs and I had them tagged for part of speech, lemmatized and tagged for part of speech, and tried to see which parts of speech are more typical of the written as opposed to the oral, which is something that one often does when analyzing corpora. And again, without going into all of the details, if you look, for example, at the line that deals with pronouns, which is all the way down here, I don't know if you can see it, for the written outputs, it's all the way down here, but for the oral outputs, it is, where is it, pronouns? Just a minute, it's further up. You'll see that the pronouns in the written output account for 3.9% of the words. I don't know if you can see it. Do we have a pointer here? Is this the pointer? Whoops, what did I do?
It's
a button. Oh well, I'm not sure which one. That's what I did.
Fred Solvich.
No, I don't know this problem. What do I do?
You turned the whole thing off. Okay, you know what? Never mind. Anthony? Yeah, right. Don't touch anything. Okay, thank you, Fred. This is okay, so we have 3.9% pronouns in the written. But if you look at the column for the oral, over there you have 6.5%. You see it all the way down line, right, exactly. Now, without going into many details about the specifics of the object of the target text, if you have 6.5% in the written and 3.9% of the oral, you at least suspect that there's some difference in, perhaps in explicitness, because pronouns, if I say in some languages, in English this isn't true, but in Hebrew it is, and in many other languages, if I say I go, and in Hebrew you can also say, or I went, in Hebrew you can also say I went in a single word without an explicit pronoun. It's a morpheme, actually, and here I counted pronouns that weren't just a morpheme. I'm sure in many other languages this is the case. The fact that there are far more pronouns in the oral outputs, in the interpreted outputs, is not surprising. But it shows that indeed the interpreters make recourse to typically oral discourse when they are interpreting, okay? Which also means that the register is considered to be lower and the explicitness is higher and the cohesive patterns are different from those of the translated outputs because the explicit pronouns make for more cohesion in a way. And a few of the other parts of speech, you see, for example, with the adjectives and a few others are different. I won't go into all the details, but some of them are clearly different. Now, you don't have to know Hebrew for this, just know numbers, okay? We have a verb form, which is typical of spoken language, and we have a verb form, which is considered to be typical of written language. Unfortunately, there are very few corpus-based studies of spoken Hebrew altogether. There's one project, and it kind of stopped because of lack of funding, so I don't have a good reference corpus to compare to. I don't have a good reference corpus of spoken Hebrew, and we're talking here about Hebrew as the target language. But there are two forms that are kind of alloforms, and typically one can choose one or the other, and the lower, the nifal form, is considered a higher register than the pa'al form. And as you see, just looking at the percentages, in the written outputs, the percentage of this is double the oral. To me, this says that interpreters, as a survival strategy or for whatever reason, make much more recourse to oral discourse patterns than they would in translation. The same interpreters translating raise the register to a much more formal level. By the same token, again, the use of the definite article, without going into issues of Hebrew grammar, you see that the percentages are considerably higher in the oral form. The use of the definite article is, again, a type of explicitness, a type of lowering of register. And another parameter of orality as opposed to spokenness, the analytic possessive. So you see that there's a numerical difference here again without going into the details. On the lexical level too, there are words that are typically more spoken and typically more written. When I say spoken, I don't mean slang. I don't mean very low colloquial. I just mean a kind of unmarked register. And if you look at the numbers at the right, you cannot but be struck, I think, by the differences between the two columns, where the more formal word is used, the more formal word is used 15 times in the written and only 3 times in the oral. And by the same token, the less formal word is used 19 times in the oral and only twice in the written. So the differences are quite obvious, where the translators resort to the more formal words than the interpreters. Use of cognates. As you can see in the oral column, you can kind of recognize the words as you look at these transcriptions of the Hebrew, operatiot, programma, and so on. These are obviously cognate forms, somewhat frowned upon by some norms in writing, and indeed in the written translations, the translators have resorted to the more correct, the more acceptable Hebrew equivalents. In fact, very often they use Hebrew equivalents, even when those equivalents are not commonly used, because this is the norm is to use these Hebrew equivalents. I had a student who recently did an extensive study of the use of transcoding and cognates in translation. She didn't look at interpreting, and she discovered, not surprisingly, that in any text having to do with computers, the use of such transcoded forms is infinitely higher than in texts having to do, for example, with politics or with the arts. So this is also a domain-specific issue, but I'm not going into that. So my last slide, which I'll use as a point of departure for summing up, comes from actually from corpus linguistics in general, where we are told back in 1994 that the importance of computer corpora in research on individual languages is now firmly established. And if they are properly compiled and properly used, these corpora, bilingual and multilingual corpora, will similarly enrich the comparative study of languages. And my claim is that these corpora, when properly compiled and properly used, will enrich our understanding of translation as a generic term, and will enrich our understanding of interpreting specifically. And just to pick up on that by way of semi-summation, what questions would we want to ask? Okay, we go to all this trouble to compile the corpora and to transcribe them and to make them accessible and so on and so forth and to align them. What questions would we want to ask? Well, obviously we would want to use corpora to validate hypotheses that we have had all along about how interpreting works, about what the interpreted product looks like, and by using large corpora, and preferably by having several researchers in several languages with several different groups of subjects and so on, with naturalistic and experimental data and so on, study corpora, we can arrive at much more rigorous findings concerning various hypotheses that we have had all along in interpreting studies. If we look at the literature of interpreting studies, certain issues come up again and again and again, which are very often tested on a small scale or maybe even just speculated about or done manually in a way that is always open to some question about the generalizability and the representativeness of the corpus that is being used. Some of the issues that might be further explored using corpora include the following. For one thing, comparing modes. Consecutive, there's an article by Daniel Gilles about whether consecutive or simultaneous, which of the two is more reliable. Of course, one has to define what we mean by reliable, what we mean by accurate, and so on. But other things being equal, we could, in fact, generate large corpora of the two, consecutive and simultaneous, and compare with source text. In other words, I think the usefulness of this technique would be fairly obvious. Looking at directionality, a very big issue in interpreting studies, taking corpora of people working into their second language, which is increasingly common nowadays, and looking specifically at the kinds of shifts that occur, again, in different language pairs. Looking at the differences between cognate and non-cognate languages. looking at corpora as a function of expertise, novice experts comparisons. And in all of these cases, we would also be looking at the strategies that are used, that are reflected. Of course, one can look at the product and try to infer about the process. One can't look directly at the process through corpora, but one can try to draw inferences about the strategies that are being used. We can, and in fact, this is something that I've begun doing, we can look at how the corpus or how the outputs are shaped by the rate of delivery. So I've been comparing corpora of outputs where the input is at 120 words per minute as opposed to 140 words a minute, the same input, and trying to see to what extent certain shifts occur. Again, looking at large quantities of data, of course, will give us more valid answers. We can look at lexical variables and syntactic variables, as I have begun doing here. And we can look at individual variation, or we can do longitudinal studies of students from beginning through several years of study and training and then out in the profession. And all that we say about anticipation and the way we use anticipation in different language pairs where the verb comes at the end or the verb particle comes at the end, and how anticipation has worked, we can look at a syntactic analysis of input-output or of different people's outputs to infer about that. Of course, when we ask the so what question, as Franz said, we can look at the so what question from the academic angle or from the social angle. And I haven't mentioned community interpreting here because, frankly, I'm not so sure that corpus-based studies would be that useful for community interpreting, but I may be wrong. I think that in dialogical interpreting, there's so much involved in the body language, in the turn-taking, in the proxemics. I don't think we're there yet in terms of the methodology, but I'd be glad to be, to hear different opinions. In any case, when it comes to this so what question, obviously this has potential for psycholinguists, for our psycholinguistic look at interpreted outputs as a window to the mind, as a window to language processing, and to how much we comprehend at any given time, how our outputs reflect that comprehension, what strategies we use, and so on. And from here, it's a small leap to teaching. If we can learn more from corpora about typical characteristics of students' outputs, perhaps we can apply this in the interpreting classroom. Hybrid forms, which again, which Franz mentioned, hybrid forms would include, for example, the following. I'm sorry to give myself as an example, but this is something that I haven't seen done much. I recently translated a book, and I tried as an experiment to translate the whole book with speech recognition software. I used Dragon Naturally Speaking, and I translated the book. And I then took the output, and I didn't do much editing while I was translating. Basically, I was doing simultaneous interpreting, but it was a sight translation, okay? I had the book in front of me, and I was sight translating the book, which is a hybrid mode, if you will, between translation and interpreting in a way. I sight translated the whole book, which was about 120, it's a fairly short book, 120 pages or so, onto the computer, practically no editing. And after that, I edited the output, and I now have a kind of, I have two texts to compare, the edited output and the interpreted output, and I intend to do something with it. I don't quite know yet what, but it's too good to resist. I want to do some kind of a corpus-based analysis, and that, for example, is an example of a hybrid form, and I suspect that there are certain patterns, which may be my own individual patterns, but some of them I imagine not, that will recur in the hybrid form, and the edited version will correct them, okay? So, all in all, I think that the corpus-based technique does hold considerable potential, of course, for translation studies as a whole. That's nothing new. But also, despite all the difficulties and obstacles, I think it holds considerable potential for interpreters, for interpreter teachers, and for psycholinguists and cognitive psychologists as well. Thank you.